Welcome to Toxic GS. I'm Jake Seward. I'm joined by Jack Farrell, longtime journalist at the Denver Post and at the Boston Globe, covered the White House, but has gone on to write several books, most recently a book about Richard Nixon. You'd written about Tip O'Neill and Clarence Darrow, sort of liberal icons at some level. How was it like? How do you reset your frame and sort of tackle Nixon's life?
Yeah, well, the challenge in biography is that you have to go in and you try to have to really, reset is a good word, you have to try to wipe the slate clean. And for people that I had admired, like Clarence Darrow, who was a childhood hero of mine, great civil libertarian, anti-death penalty, pro-union lawyer back around the turn of the last century, or Tip O'Neill, who I actually knew when I was working at the Boston Globe and admired, I had to be skeptical. And I had to turn up the skeptical dial more and try to step back and say, okay, watch out here. Don't start gushing. With Nixon, it was the other way around. Richard Nixon was the evil guy who invaded Cambodia and got caught up in Watergate, and even in his early parts of his career, got into office basically with some of the worst red baiting, helped create the atmosphere that led to McCarthyism in the 1950s. So there was lots of reasons not to like Nixon, and what I found was surprising was that it was surprisingly easy for me to begin to appreciate him. As soon as I got into it and began reading his correspondence, his love letters to his wife, or his correspondence back to his college girlfriend, or his even some of the tapes, there is a side of him. And the people that knew him and were still alive, they had this almost emotional protectiveness about him, like he's the troubled child in the family who, you know, tried to do good but kept screwing up. And that became the theme of the book.
So when he was recruited out of the Navy to run against Jerry Vorace, who was sort of a, you know, classic, even though he's a California congressman, had the kind of classic East Coast establishment pedigree, Nixon runs a pretty negative campaign. Now, did you think it was negative by the standards of the time, or was it uniquely negative? He manages to beat an incumbent, which is always difficult, an incumbent who's reasonably well-funded and reasonably well-known. Did he just begin, once he decided to take on that challenge to get himself involved in politics, was it just win at any costs?
It was definitely win at any costs. He just, he came from, his father was a citrus farmer who managed to be so bad at it that he couldn't grow citrus in Southern California, in Orange County. And a very bitter, abusive man, finally moved the family to a highway outside of Whittier, California, where he bought a deserted church and turned it into a grocery store. So there's like this gothic picture of Nixon. And while he's growing up, two of his brothers die. The baby brother, Arthur, with these golden curls that everybody loves, dies in a week of meningitis. And then the eldest brother, the champion of the family, the favored son, gets tuberculosis and takes years to die. He and his mother, they go to Arizona to try to save his life through the with the climate, the dry climate in Arizona. It doesn't work. And so there's this really awful gothic childhood that Nixon has to endure. And he's one of the least likely people that you could ever think of to come back from war and be a successful politician because he has these immense personality flaws. But compensating for all that is this audacious drive, a tremendous resiliency, able to lose the presidency and come back, and a fantastic memory. And he was an actor. Nobody ever caught the fact that he was an actor.
Yeah, that was super interesting about how well he acted in high school and was a leading man.
Yeah. When he met his wife.
And one thing everyone sort of remembers the presidential race, but if you go back several years in time, he arrives at the same time another former Navy vet shows up, John Kennedy, and they're pretty friendly.
Extraordinarily friendly. And again, another surprise that I ran across as I was doing the research. Kennedy's family was much more conservative than the Kennedys that we think of in retrospect. His father was a friend of Joe McCarthy. John Kennedy was personally tremendously, and Bobby Kennedy too, tremendously ill at ease with black people starting out. Had no no connection. So they were like this Irish Catholic Massachusetts family, and here comes this other guy from the other side of the continent who shares their anti-communism and who shares their, or shares Jack Kennedy's fascination with foreign affairs. And they end up going up to McKeesport, Pennsylvania to do a debate one night on the Taft-Hartley Labor Act. Yeah. They get back on the train and they stay up all night talking to each other. This, you know, this rich ambassador's kid from Massachusetts and this poor farmer's kid from California. And they strike up a friendship. And we all have heard about Jack Kennedy's illnesses when he was a young man, a young congressman and senator. But at one time, he was very near death. And at one time, Nixon went to see him in the hospital at Walter Reed and almost collapsed in the hallway afterwards, staggering against the wall and weeping, poor Jack, poor brave Jack is going to die. And that's how close they were. When Kennedy ran for re-election to the Senate, Nixon refused to go in and campaign for the Republican candidate. That's how close they were.
So Nixon has this unbelievably meteoric rise. He runs and wins in 46, re-elected in 48, runs for Senate in 50 against a liberal icon from sort of Hollywood. And by 52, he's on the national ticket as Dwight Eisenhower's vice president.
Yeah.
How did that happen so quickly?
Yeah.
How did he rise to attention so rapidly?
There's like a yin yang to Nixon's career. For every awful thing that he does, there's a compensating factor that makes you go, huh? I guess he wasn't so bad after all. I often thought that I should title the book "And Then," you know. Or on the other hand. And so that in 1946 he runs, and he runs a somewhat scurrilous red-baiting race against this New Deal liberal, and he wins. Then he gets to Washington, and one of the first assignments he gets is to go to war-torn Europe and examine things as a member of a House delegation, and his assignment is to come back and tell the Republicans and the conservatives in the House whether or not they should vote for the Marshall Plan. And at that time, and we look back at the Marshall Plan now and think that it was a unanimous, brilliant move of American diplomacy, but it wasn't. It was very controversial.
Spending a lot of money on the losers.
On the losers. They were going to be socialists anyway.
Right.
And especially the hardcore conservatives of Southern California thought it was pouring sand down a rat hole, as one of his mentors wrote him in a letter. So Nixon goes over there, and he's immediately persuaded that it's actually a good idea. And he comes back, and so in his district, it's probably running 80-20 against the Marshall Plan. He turns it around that first time and not only gets renominated by a skeptical Republican Party. In California, you can actually do this. He wins the Democratic nomination as well. And so when he runs in 1948, he's elected by acclamation. They like him so much. So that's the good side of Nixon. 2 years later, he decides to run for Congress against a liberal Democrat named Helen Gehagen Douglas. And he runs probably the most scurrilous campaign of his career. Awful red baiting, a sexual innuendo about this female candidate, you know, one after another, and defeats her and comes to Washington. So there's always this, as you read about Nixon, there's always this, wow, he wasn't so bad after all. And then a few more pages are like, oh my God, I can't believe he did that. So.
Talk a little bit about his service under Eisenhower. I mean, 8 years. He was never particularly liked, but he obviously built a political network that served him well.
Yeah,
well,
Eisenhower had spent, before he even got to World War II, Eisenhower had spent 30 years in the Army, worked his way up to be general. He was the supreme commander, the liberator of Europe. He was used to dealing with de Gaulle and Winston Churchill and Franklin Roosevelt and George Marshall, and he comes back and he's almost elected by acclaim as president of the United States. And Dick Nixon is a Navy lieutenant who spent most of his time unloading and unloading planes in the South Pacific. And so to Eisenhower, Nixon is staff. He's, you know, a guy that you give orders for coffee to. He's, you know, and that's exaggerating a little bit. It wasn't quite that bad. But Nixon so wanted to be an intimate of Eisenhower. He so wanted to be accepted in Eisenhower's circle of friends who played golf at Augusta National and had steak nights and played bridge. And Eisenhower just never invited him into that circle and was always looking at him as this strange sort of duck that's on my staff and that I have to keep busy somehow, and kept him around. And it was a very rough relationship, and it was capped off after the first term when Eisenhower decided that he wanted to get rid of Nixon. But Nixon had built up enough of a popular following that Ike didn't want to be obvious about it. And so he set out to undermine Nixon for a period of about 6 months and finally threw up his hands and said, you know, I'm never going to get this Weasley guy off the ticket, so I guess I might as well accept it. But it was agony for Nixon, a very bad relationship.
Moving on, Nixon runs against Kennedy, loses a very narrow victory. What lessons did he take away from that?
The worst lesson of all, which was that he believed that the Kennedys had outspent and outcheated him. He believed that he may have even have won that election, that they stole the election in Illinois and Texas. They would have had to steal in two states. And Nixon never had the proof to show that they did, but given his character, given that insecurity and that gnawing flaw of his, it just ate at him. And his daughter, Julie, said that that was the moment when Daddy swore he would never be out-cheated again. And because of his personality, that meant that he would be excessive. And it is almost a direct line from that, the feeling of that loss of, and not just that he lost the election, but that he'd been cheated out of it by his friend,
Jack Kennedy.
And that stayed with him forever. And there's a great anecdote that's not in the book of a Secret Service agent walking down the campaign airplane in the 1968 campaign when Richard Nixon is running again for president. And he comes upon Nixon, and Nixon doesn't know he's there. And he sees Nixon is sitting there in the chair going, "Gotta be tougher, gotta be tougher, gotta be tougher," as if he wasn't tough enough already. Yeah.
Speaking of tough in the 68 election, you've uncovered some new information around how Nixon scuttled the peace deal in 68 that made sure that the Democrats wouldn't get any credit for bringing the Vietnam War to an end. Talk a little bit about, first of all, how did you discover something new when everything's already been studied? And
Well, like I said, there was a tremendous flow of new stuff that was coming out. And Nixon had fought successfully as long as he was alive and for many years thereafter. His lawyer and his foundation kept a hold on his political papers from the 60, 62, and 68 campaign. And in them were this bunch of notes from his chief of staff, a guy named Bob Haldeman. And there had been immediate rumors that this was happening. And what happened was the Russians looked in 1968 at the United States and said, well, you know, Hubert Humphrey, liberal Democrat's going to be give us a better deal than Richard Nixon, Cold War, anti-communist. So what can we do that would help Hubert Humphrey and Lyndon Johnson, who was then the president? And so they sent a note to Johnson, and they said, if you have a bombing halt, we will make sure that North Vietnam comes to the table and that the talks are productive.
Because they were supplying all the arms.
They were the quartermaster for the North Vietnamese. And so the election's over, and all of a sudden there's these rumors that somehow Saigon, the government of South Vietnam, had dragged its feet against this initiative from the Soviet Union, and that the Republicans had encouraged them. So Nixon always denied it, just said absolutely, had nothing to do with it. Over the years, investigative reporters and historians find the actual person, a woman named Madame Cheneau, who had sent the messages to the South Vietnamese. The Johnson Library releases documents and tapes from inside the White House, which shows that side of the story. But Nixon always insists he had nothing to do with it, and on David Frost, the famous David Frost interviews, he specifically asked, and he says, I could never have done that in good conscience. No, I had nothing to do with Mrs. Chennault. And sure enough, as you go through these files from the 68 campaign, there are Haldeman's notes, and he's writing down what Nixon is saying, and Nixon is saying, keep Anna Chennault working on the South Vietnamese. Anything we can do to monkey wrench Lyndon Johnson's initiative. That was my great contribution to history. Yeah.
So when Watergate does happen, the burglars get caught. They're incredibly inept. And they, I mean, the real issue is in many ways, is as they say, not the crime, but the cover-up. But Nixon begins a massive campaign to get everyone to pay everyone off to try to contain the scandal and keep it under wraps. Was it inevitable that he would get impeached over this? I mean, he was reasonably popular. What instinct was it of his? Did they ever stop to consider what they were doing, or did they just sort of go into protective mode immediately and doom themselves right at the get-go?
Well, I mean, the single worst thing that he did was install a taping system at the White House. And he did it because he was afraid that Henry Kissinger would steal all the accolades for his foreign policy successes. And so he wanted a record that he could pull out one day when he wrote his own memoirs and say, it wasn't Henry, it was me, here on XX a day when we're talking about it. You know, look how Henry was kissing my butt.
Which he was able to do in the end. Anyway.
Which he was
a pretty good memoir,
yeah,
right?
They both wrote fantastic memoirs.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so did Haldeman. I mean, we're really
right.
Blessed by those memoirs. But but the tapes are really what doomed him. I believe that he would not have been thrown out of office. Would not have gotten the votes of impeachment in the House Judiciary Committee if the evidence was not on the tapes. At that time, impeachment was something that hadn't happened in 100 years, and when it did happen with Andrew Johnson, it had been discredited in every account of those days as an excessive movement by radical Republicans to dump a legitimately elected, or not elected, but a legitimate president. And so it's not like today where we go right to impeachment because we've had
pretty many scandals.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So, there's always someone who wants to get on TV by saying, "Let's impeach the president."
Let's impeach the president, right? So there was a big psychological block about dumping a president, and especially during the Cold War when the Ruskies with 20,000 nuclear missiles aimed at us were on the other side. So without the tapes, I don't think he would have been impeached. But they capture him again, you know, setting the dirty tricks in motion and then trying to cover up again at the end. And the amount of evidence is overwhelming of his personal involvement.
Right. So Woodward and Bernstein, others have written about the final days at the White House and the chaos there. Nixon was really descending into drinking a lot, very incoherent. A couple of people are trying to hold it all together. Kissinger's still there and others. But, You wrote something up. But there's a certain amount of chaos in the current White House. But describe a little bit like how someone, whatever you think of him, Henry Kissinger, a grown-up, mature person trying to hold it all together in that environment, how that felt at the time.
Okay, so this is from Arthur Burns was the chairman of the Federal Reserve. He's very close friends with Henry Kissinger, and they decide that Nixon is losing it. And this is from Arthur Burns' diary, right? And so Nixon is determined that he's going to keep interest rates down, and he's going to pressure Arthur Burns to do it. This is Arthur Burns writing in his diary. The president looked wild, looked like a desperate man, released a torrent of resentment against me. I'm convinced that the president will do anything to be reelected. There were moments during this meeting when I felt the president was going mad. His features became twisted, and what I saw was uncontrolled cruelty. I was seized suddenly with fear for the safety of our country, which depended so heavily on this insecure man. And so it was pretty nerve-wracking stuff. And in fact, his Secretary of Defense, James Schlesinger, sent word through the Joint Chiefs that, you know, if you get any, like, orders out of the White House that, you know, to send the 1st Marine Battalion to, you know, arrest Congress, you know, we're going to clear it by me first, okay, guys? And so there was legitimate worry about the mental state of the president, his reckless behavior, and what that could end up leading to. The original title for the book was Richard Nixon, An American Tragedy. And it's no insight unique to me. Henry Kissinger has said it, Elliot Richardson has said it, that this is a guy who had classic Greek or Shakespearean tragedy for a life arc. He starts out, he's smart, he claws his way up out of the backwoods of Southern California, but all along there's this tragic flaw, and he sees it, and there's nothing he can do about it. And like a great Shakespearean tragic character, in the end, it causes his downfall.
All right. Thank you very much, Jack.
Sure.